Good evening, good afternoon, and a very warm welcome to all our viewers. Welcome to this IPA 50 webinar series, New Horizons in Physics. Today we are on the second lecture for this series, and the first lecture I'm very happy to announce had a very good, was very well received. We have had more than 700 views on the lecture, which is available offline. I hope to and look forward to the enthusiastic response to all the lectures in the series. Today we have Professor Ravindra Kumar, who is working with high intensity lasers and will tell us about very exciting things in this field, extreme science at the tabletop. Before we go on to the lecture, I again a warm request to all of you to subscribe to our channel if you haven't already done so, and keep visiting our webpage. Address is available both in the YouTube and the Zoom chat as the lecture progresses, to look for our future program. Today, for the coordinating this lecture, we have a young faculty member, a young professor from IIT Dhanbad, Professor Amitabh Adak. He did his PhD at TIFR under the guidance of Professor Ravindra Kumar, and he himself is very fond of playing with light sources for generating bright coherent light with the higher harmonics. So I invite now Dr. Amitabh Adak to conduct today's lecture and introduce the speaker.
Hi, thank you so much. It's an honor for me to introduce Professor G. Ravindra Kumar, today's speaker. He actually obtained his PhD from IIT Kanpur 1990, and then basically he has been in TFR from early 90s till today, and doing great work, great research. And I am really fortunate, you know, to be in contact with him for almost a decade now. And he explores extreme physics, extreme light matter interactions, which you will be listening today. So he has numerous awards in his bags, starting from Indian Academy Science Award, National Science Academy Award, Birla Prize, Bhatnagar Prize, to J.C. Bose Fellowship, and then of course the Infosys Prize in Physical Science in 2015. So it will be countless to mention all of these, but without spending much time, I would like to request Professor G. Ravindra Kumar to take over and please start his talk.
Well, thank you, Vandana, colleague at TIFR, who's just, you know, got me to give this talk today, this evening. But I'm very happy that she has actually given me this opportunity. And to be, you know, coordinated by a former student is also a pleasure. And I have to be on my toes because Vandana knows me for a long time, so I can't do any wrong steps now. And Amitabh knows the work that I'm going to talk about, so I hope I don't disappoint him either. Okay, so let's begin by looking at the topic today. And if all of you can see, let me check if all of you can actually see the share screen. Okay, so I hope the screen is visible in full glory. Is it okay, Vandana? Is it visible?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, great. Yeah. So extreme states on a tabletop, I know it conjures up various visions in your mind, because what one considers extreme may not be extreme for other people. So let me define, I'll go along and define what is meant by extreme in our part of the scientific community. So this is extreme states, and the real play is on doing them on a tabletop. And extreme states are there everywhere in the universe, but how do you actually create them and study them on a tabletop is the topic that we will talk about today. And I am at the Uphill Labs in TIFR. So, and that's my email address. You're welcome to write to me after this talk or any other time. And then you can also visit our website there and post questions, look at some of the sources which are there, which describe our work. So lots of people, Amitava included, who have actually pushed this work over a long period of time, almost 20 years, and collaborators from across the world, mostly for theory, but also some for experiment. And in fact, TIFR, like the accelerator that we have, where different nationalities, people come from different nations and do the experiments. The laser facilities that we have are also used by people across the world in some of the labs that pursue this area. So some of the pictures of bright young people who make these things happen, and colleagues and young students and postdocs, pictures in the lab. And you can see another colleague of mine who is a principal investigator with me. He's also pushing this area extremely hard. M. Krishnamurthy, who is standing here. And then we are all at different stages in our evolution in this area. So these are collaborators from the UK and collaborators from within India to whom we owe a particular debt of gratitude, because these are the people who have taught a tremendous amount of plasma physics. None of us had a background in plasma physics when we began this work, but with their help and mentoring, we have learned a lot of things in the last two decades. And particularly to Professor Kao, I want to pay my tributes for he's one of the brightest people I've come in contact with, extremely brilliant as a physicist, a great leader that India knows. In fact, I would say a global leader in plasma physics, and a great teacher, wonderful person. And it's too sad that he passed away rather early in his life. So let me just begin by saying, what is this talk all about, so that you can keep this focus? So we are talking about extreme states, but before extreme states comes extreme light, from our point of view. It's extreme light which creates extreme states. So what is extreme light? So extreme light, as we define, is it's a pulsed light produced from a what is called a femtosecond laser, ultra-short pulse laser. And it has reasonable energy. It need not have abnormally high amounts of energy, but it has reasonable amount of energy. But the crucial thing is that all this energy is packed into a very, very short duration of time. And so this is what we define as extreme light. And we will see what extremities it reaches when you manipulate this light. So this is, again, since the audience consists, I was told that consists of lots of undergraduate students too. So I'd like to take you through a few slides to set the basics right. So all of us know that when energy is packed in the form of pulses, we have this notion of what is called the peak power. So normally, if you have a steady stream of energy coming at you per second, for example, 1 joule in 1 second, that's what we call as 1 watt or 1 unit of power. But imagine the same thing emitted as a burst in a very short time, like 1 picosecond. That already makes it something like 10 to the 12 watts or 1 terawatt. And all the time, the light does not change its photon energy. So the photon energy remains the same. It's about an EV or so, an EV or two EVs. But the intensity or the flux that you can impinge on a target, that just shoots up dramatically if you shrink it in time. Right? So this is one of the key concepts in this area. And the extremities are in the shrinking that you do to the light pulse. I mean, the way you shrink the time duration, that's one of the characteristics of this extreme light. So this extreme light, for example, at TIFR, we have what is called a 100 terawatt laser, 3 joules emitted in 30 femtoseconds. And that can be focused down to a very small spot. And when it's focused down to 10 microns, you can produce an intensity which is 10 to the 19 watts per centimeter square. And you might be thinking, what is 10 to the 19? What does it mean for me? It'll become clear very soon. But just keep track of this, that you take a short pulse, some light energy which is emitted in a very short burst, and that's in time domain, and then confine it also in spatial domain by focusing it with a tight focusing optic. And that's where you create this extraordinarily large intensities. So this is what for us means extreme light in this area. And this laser, of course, celebrated 60 years this year from the summer of 1960, when Maiman made the first laser in Hughes labs to all the way to the present stage where people are talking of, you know, building giant powers in these lasers, huge, abnormally large powers. And all this has happened over the last, say, 30 years or so, 30 or 40 years. When the lasers, for 20 years since, when after the lasers were born, the peak powers got confined to something like a gigawatt or a few tens of gigawatt. But then there was a revolution in laser technology in the mid 80s, and like several other revolutions in the world in that decade. So that pushed everything by a factor of 100 to 1000. So from gigawatt levels, you went to terawatt. And from terawatt, you now are rising inexorably on that upper curve that you have on the right hand side. So you're now, petawatt lasers are common now, becoming common. Petawatt is 10 to the 15 watt. So that is 1000 terawatt. That's becoming common. People are now going to something like 100 petawatt. So that's the goal, is to go to 100 petawatt in the next 5-6 years, or maybe next decade or so. And that is causing a tremendous amount of excitement in this field. So I have written here, bringing the stars down to earth. And this is the theme that I will be pursuing for a little later in the talk, after I set the benchmarks for what this laser power and what this laser intensity actually mean. So at the bottom, you have one of those big lasers which amplifies light to these petawatt powers. This is, I think, a Japanese laser. And this is our laser. So we'd like to show off the laser that we have at TIFR. And this is some quadrants of this laser. I call this tabletop. I have emphasized the tabletop nature of this source, because you know, you can have a laser pretty much like a big accelerator occupying a whole building. But the beauty of this area, the real remarkable diversity and the sort of democratization of this area happened because of the compactness of the lasers, which happened in the mid 80s. And so the tabletop, perhaps two tables, it can be fitted in a room of say something like 6 by 6 meter square, or 10 by 10 meter square if you're a little more liberal. And this shows different quadrants of the laser, different parts of the laser. The green light is the light pumping the amplifiers, and the orange glow is that of the titanium sapphire crystal. And it is this glow, a part of this glow, which is amplified as a femtosecond pulse in our lab, or typically in these trisapphire lasers. So we also have, the thing about this is that as the power goes up, the rep rates that I've listed here, this is only a 5 hertz laser. That is, you have 5 pulses per second. Coming up. But then there's been a remarkable revolution even on matching the rep rates to, you know, trying to go towards the accelerator scales. For example, there are kilohertz lasers, which Amitava has used extensively. He began by using a few hertz lasers, and then he graduated to kilohertz lasers in great style. So this is a kilohertz laser. So 1000 pulses per second, or a few 1000 pulses per second. And the intensities are not so monstrous like, you know, 10 to the 19, 10 to the 20. Maybe we'll get there in a short while, even at high rep rates. But this is about somewhat modest, about 10 to the 15, 10 to the 16. But still, a lot of exciting things can be done at these 10 to the 16 watts per centimeter square intensity. So this is again a laser that we have. We have some of those lasers here. But this laser at our new campus in Hyderabad is already being used very effectively for several studies in this high intensity laser physics area. So these are the people who made the laser revolution possible. On the left, actually in the inset, you have Donna Strickland, who was a graduate student with Gerard Moreau, who is at the center of the other photo there, beaming away. Gerard was the advisor who thought of this brainwave to make these lasers, which is known as chirp pulse amplified lasers. And Donna was a student who actually made these lasers happen. And the paper was published in 1985. And that was the mid 80s, which sparked off this entire revolution. And justifiably, we're all proud to know that these people received the Nobel Prize in 2018, along with Arthur Ashkin. So the 2018 Nobel Prize was very interesting. Arthur Ashkin worked with very low intensity lasers, and you know, very normal, simple lasers, on the other hand, and continuous lasers to begin with. So they were not pulsed. And then you have Gerard and Donna, who actually shrunk the pulses to the smallest durations possible and then amplified. So it had two extremes. The Nobel Prize itself had two extremes in the same year. So that is again very interesting about this area. So this is, as I said, the wheel is turning rapidly for intense lasers. This is all the laser facilities in the world which claim to have high intensities and which are going further and further up the scale. Now, this is the International Committee on Ultra-Intense Lasers. of which I've been a part from 2008. And we also had a conference, you know, the international conference, which goes every 2 years across the continents. We had the pleasure of hosting their conference in Goa in 2014, as, you know, TFR organized that conference. And so if you look at this web map, if you go to the web and click on any one of these facilities, you'll actually know what the facilities are, who is responsible for this, how do you contact them for beam times, and what their plans are, what the specifications are, everything, and what, you know, other experimental capabilities they provide. So please do take a look. And we are also happy to plant the Indian flag here, saying that, you know, we have BARC has lasers like this. RR CAT now has a petawatt laser. And TFR has had hundreds of terawatt, and we're also going towards the petawatt at TFR Hyderabad. So, so now let's see scaling up light intensities. That's the next theme. But first, how high is high, or how intense is intense? So again, you know, in physics, we normally have benchmarks which are used to compare across areas. So in atomic physics and in optical physics, the benchmarks are typically provided by atomic scales. So if you take an atom, the hydrogen atom, 1s electron, the electron experiences a field of 10 to the 9 volts per centimeter, which translates to 10 to the 16 watts per centimeter square. And a few years ago, many, many years ago, actually, people focused ultra-short pulses down to, you know, down to a very small scale, almost at the level of their wavelength, and then produced intensities which are 10 to the 22 watts per centimeter square. So you look at this, you marvel at this. It's a million times larger than the Coulombic intensity. What we have written above is called the Coulombic intensity as one atomic unit of intensity. And you can beat it by a factor of a million. And so this is abnormal. This is just not encountered in many other areas where we actually apply such extraordinarily large you know, drivers on matter. And this is obviously does something very interesting. Even at modest intensities, like 10 to the 13, 14 watts per centimeter square, which are sub-Coulombic, you already have this process which is known as multiphoton ionization. So all of us learn that the photoelectric effect demands that the photon energy should match the energy gap for an excitation to happen. If you want to ionize, you should come up with probably ultraviolet light for most systems, or X-ray light for most systems. But here it is, this, you know, this one EV photon at huge fluxes can actually ionize many, many atoms, right? By building up what is called a photon ladder, or by doing what is called multiphoton ionization. So this is extremely interesting, and quite, it's a modification of the standard photoelectric effect that we know. And if you go to higher intensities at 10 to the 16 and above, or well on the way to 10 to the 16 watts per centimeter square on a laser pulse, you can distort the barrier of the Coulombic barrier, which is shown here. It's a one-dimensional model, minus Q by X. And that can be dramatically distorted by a perturbation, or I would not call it a perturbation, I would call it a strong disturbance of E dot X, and it's plus minus E dot X because it's oscillating. The light cycle is actually an oscillation. So you can have this seesaw, that's where you have a bound potential which is bent in such a way that the electron can actually tunnel out of the barrier. And this is called tunneling ionization. And for some very interesting, if you look back at the history, this was discussed way back in 1928 by Oppenheimer, that the fact that, you know, under strong light fields, the electrons can tunnel out of atoms. That was too well before all these lasers became possible, but it's still very insightful that they thought of it even at that time. So this is tunnel ionization. So the basic thing is that, you know, if you have most of the periodic table, if you have atoms, then if you have strong enough intensities, you will end up ionizing them. At least one electron, maybe sometimes two, three, four electrons, just by the light field. And not only that, if you have, you ionize the electron very rapidly on the rising edge of the light pulse, and then you also give them lots of oscillation energy. And why does this oscillation energy happen? Because the light is, suppose you take a polarized light wave, and the light wave has an electric field, which is a fixed direction, and the electron will be jumped up and down on this, along this direction. And because the intensity is very large, you can actually push the electron very far from its equilibrium position. So as the pulse evolves from left to right, or reaches intensity, you know, along the y-axis, you can also give this electron an abnormally large value of, you know, amplitude of oscillation, which is 10 to 100 nanometers. And again, compared with the Bohr atom is sub-angstrom, right? So it's a fraction of a nanometer. And from there, now you pull electrons as far away as 10 to 100 nanometers. So this is extremely abnormal kind of excitation that happens. And if you compute the energy that you give to the electron, if the electron takes away the energy under certain appropriate conditions by this excitation, then that amounts to about 1 mega electron volt for a normal ticefire laser, 0.8 micron wavelength at an intensity of something like 10 to the 19 watts per centimeter square. So let me just pause and say, emphasize these points. The light is still 1.5 eV photons or so, right? The photon energy is the same, but the energy that's given to the particle is extraordinarily large. I mean, it just beats it by a factor of a million. And keep thinking about where else you will encounter this kind of excitations in any other branch of physics. So this is, as I said, very unusual. And if you compute the moment you hear of mega electron volts for laser, you know that they are actually relativistic. And to kick an electron to such high speeds or high energies in a fraction of a picosecond calls for abnormally large accelerations. So this is again something where everything starts looking unusually large, and you know, people take time to accept that this is what is actually happening. But indeed it does, and many, many labs around the world, these experiments are routinely done. So now this is a nice thing. And in fact, I recall that this is from Amitava's thesis seminar. So with his permission. So you have light field, the scales are increasing. You can see that the peaks are going higher and higher. So you have plasma formation at 10 to the 14 watts per centimeter square. You can exceed the Coulombic intensity above 10 to the 16. Then you can go to what is relativistic intensity at 10 to the 18. Relativistic means that the electrons that are excited by this light are now reaching intensities which are, velocities of electrons are reaching the speeds, the speeds are matching that of light. And if you go to abnormally high intensities, hopefully in the next few years, 5 into 10 to the 24, then even protons will become relativistic. So imagine driving a proton to relativistic speeds with photon energies, particle energies at the level of a few eV, 1 eV or 2 eV. So this is something very, very dramatic, and it's been happening. So if you see this, you know, a huge pulse comes, excites it, and gives it a huge amplitude, gives it a huge energy, and the Coulomb glue cannot just hold on to this electron anymore. And if you look at the intensity scale on the right-hand side, you have a thermometer or intensity meter for the intensity there, and that reaches 10 to the 20 watts per centimeter square. And compare this with normal day-to-day optics, right? And here you see beautiful phenomenon, the rainbow. These days in Mumbai or in many parts of India, you know, plenty of rain and partial rain, partial sunlight. And so we can see these beautiful rainbows across the sky. But this happens, all these day-to-day optics, for most of us, you know, who don't work in this area, it's all about very small light intensity. It's like 1 watt per centimeter square, right? This slide, I think you should probably take home with you, saying that the photon energies are of the order of 10 to the 0 eV. Ionization energy of some atoms, at least many atoms across the periodic table, is at the level of 10 to the 1, 10 to the 2 eV for the valence electrons. So this is much, much larger than photon energy. And so you can still ionize many of these atoms just by the field alone. But you can also give energy to the ionized electron, which is actually much, 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 much larger than both the above energy scales. So this can be kept in mind while talking about what extreme light does to matter. So, but now let me define what are extreme states. And extreme states, for example, are high density of matter coupled with high temperature. So I'll take a pause again here. Normally these things are counter in the sense that if you have a high density system, it's usually at a cold temperature. And if you have high temperature, then the density of that matter goes down. But how do you excite a system at high density and raise its temperature to a very, very high value? So this is what is known as the high energy density. So it's the energy density, which is extremely large per unit volume. The energy per unit volume is extremely large. So the reason this actually does it, how is it created by an ultrafast laser? And this was discovered in the 90s when these pulses became rapidly available, is that the pulse heats the preferentially heats the electrons inside the system, inside the target. It heats them so fast, it heats them on timescales of femtoseconds, that the ions which are in the neighborhood, which are holding these electrons, don't even know that this excitation has taken place. In other words, the ions remain frozen in their positions while the electrons get heated to these extremely large temperatures and, you know, given this extremely large excitation. So this is the reason that density is actually provided by the ions, the ionic lattice, and but the electrons which absorb light in the visible region, for example, take all the energy and get heated to a very, very high temperature. But they have not, you know, the density is still that of the solid. So you can have a solid now at extremely large temperatures. And this can be called what is called high temperature solid state physics, if you will. So this is what happens that, you know, you have, let me have this cartoon. So light pulse comes, very high intensity, and then, you know, it ionizes, makes the electrons jump up and down. And then at the end of it, not only the field ionization, that is the direct ionization by the light wave, but also the collisional ionization by the electrons which are traversing the lattice. This combined effect of these two is what leads to this 10 to the 23 particles per cc, free electrons, so at the solid density, liberated electrons, but raised to the temperature of something like 10 to 100 eV over the bulk plasma region. Most of the plasma region will have electrons of this kind of energies or temperatures. And the ions did not move. So this is what happens typically. So again, you consider a pulse. We have shown that in this, you know, in this big pulse, the mountain sitting there. And so the pulse starts increasing intensity from this rising edge. Right on the rising edge, if you have a very high intensity, right on the rising edge, you reach intensities which are very, the multiproton ionization will happen, tunnel ionization will happen, followed by collisional absorption if you have a dense medium. And after that, so now that you ask the question, so what happens to the rest of the time? You know, what happens to the rest of the time? I will tell you that in a short while. So you have all this, you have now collisional absorption of this excited electrons and ionic states. Now this is a plasma, and the plasma now acts like a collective medium. And the plasma is now like a gas, hot ionized gas, which is expanding away from the surface from where it has been created. So on the right hand side, if you see, we have the number density versus you know, the distance here. So on the right hand side, you have the solid target. All these experiments are done in vacuum. So you come with a pulse, say, and you create the plasma on this surface here, and the plasma then starts blooming towards, free expansion of this plasma takes place in the vacuum. And of course, the plasma expansion undergoes various stages, but you can imagine that it is some sort of a profile. Let's call it an exponential profile. Now, so you have an expanding electron, you know, ion cloud, which has got an inhomogeneous density profile. Now, suppose you send a second light pulse, just for as an example. The light pulse will penetrate the plasma till what is called a critical layer. Now, what is a critical layer? So the plasma has collective oscillations, which are known as plasmons. And the plasmons have a frequency, which is given by a square root of n, the number density. So the plasmon frequency is varying across its inhomogeneous profile. So at some point of time, the light frequency will be matched by the plasma frequency in that varying distance, varying the spatially varying profile there. And at that place, you know, the dielectric function is given by this epsilon at the bottom left. And you see that it's given by this 1 minus omega p squared, which is this characteristic frequency of the plasmons here. And omega is applied frequency. So you know that if this becomes larger than 1, then this becomes negative, refractive index becomes imaginary, and then light gets attenuated. So that distance at that density at which this actually happens is called the critical layer. This side is called underdense, and that side is called overdense. So now this plasma that's being created by the this laser pulse here, after the initial plasma formation, when the density starts increasing, very soon this plasma and excitation of the collective processes will start taking over. So the moment the temperature and density rise to a certain value, collective processes take over. And I'll show you one of the collective processes that happens. So typically this is what is known as resonance absorption. And resonance absorption happens, the details are not important right now, but you have to choose your light polarization correctly. And the light polarization has to have an electric field component, which is perpendicular to the gradient of the plasma. So it has to go, you know, normal to the expanding plasma. And if it has a electric field component along that, you can actually drive these plasma oscillations very, very nicely. So you have this critical surface, a light pulse comes, and at this place, it can excite these plasma oscillations. And then this is how it actually happens. So you have, say, you have some sort of a profile indicated in this box here, and the light pulse comes, oscillates these electrons. And then once it oscillates, it also dumps energy because of dissipation in the plasma, and then goes off at a certain reflectivity. Now, if the plasma, of course, the waves can be built only up to a certain point. Beyond a certain point, they cannot be sustained in the plasma, so they crash. And the crash is pretty much like what happens when you see a tsunami on the seas, right? And this is a very violent thing, you know, following an earthquake that we have experienced many times in the recent past, particularly in Japan, also in the Indian Ocean region, is that you have these huge amplitude waves which are built up by the, you know, by the dramatic, the earthquake that happens. And then, but the waves cannot be sustained endlessly. So if you look at it, this is actually something like, you know, it's falling over, you know, the sort of water is falling over itself. So this in mathematical terms is what is called a multivalued function at the same x. It has different velocities. And so this is what is called a tsunami. So now just replace the electrons, replace the water with electrons. And this is what you have in a plasma when you drive it extremely hard under the correct conditions. So, but then what happens? So you have this critical layer. Let's see again. So you have these light pulse coming and then these waves crash. Then they release particles. Now all the energy of the waves gets into these particles. And this some of the particles which benefit from this crash streak into the solid behind the critical layer and cause excitation there. So if you see on the left-hand side behind this critical layer or to the left of the critical layer, all the work of excitation is being done by these very fast electrons who have benefited from the crash of the plasma waves. So in a sense, it's a relay race between the light and the electrons. So light only penetrates to the critical layer, but then the rest of the work behind the critical layer is done by these femtosecond electron pulses. So this is how, again, a take-home slide, plasma formation, how it happens in a dense medium, ionization of valence electrons, acceleration, then collisional and collective absorptions repeatedly happen. And then at the end of it, you have this exploding plasma, which has been created, where you can have abnormally, unusually large excitations or the extreme states that I was talking about. So we have come, I have mentioned this, let me just show you this in a different way. So this is the time scales on the x-axis. And you see that the reason the electrons respond very nicely to optical frequencies because they are light. And so they can move on those time scales. Typical optical frequencies are 10 to the 14, 10 to the 15 hertz. And the electrons can certainly move because they're light enough. But the ions take much larger time. They take about picoseconds to move. So while the electrons get excited, the ions remain static. And that's the reason for the high energy density. And mind you, that this high energy density sustained only so long as the ions don't move dramatically. If the ions move, the density level goes down and the extreme state is not sustained anymore. So it's a very, very transient state. So this is a recurring theme in all these experiments that the ions did not move. So the electrons move, but the ions don't move. And so this is the physics in ultra-intense light fields. You have very, very large charge densities coupled with high energy particles. So 10 to the 24 implies that you can strip off 10 electrons per atom from a solid. And that is indeed possible in some experiments. And the energetic electrons, so I talked about KeV to MeV electrons, you can create them in this kind of a plasma. And everything is driven very, very rapidly. So it's highly non-equilibrium. And everything here in this situation reaches monstrous values. For example, if I ask you to imagine what it means to have a pressure of 1 billion atmospheres, 1 billion bars, I don't think you will have a feeling because on the Earth, we have one atmosphere. And but on the other hand, if you go deep into a planet, you start approaching megabars. And if you go deep into the Earth, deep into Jupiter and so on and so forth, you start reaching megabars and hundreds of megabars, right? But you can create that right inside a lab with a laser intensity like this. Temperatures are again abnormal. And this is one area of physics which cannot be classified as being belonging to a certain area, certain sub-area of physics, because it deals with everything. It can deal with plasma physics, some of these things have astrophysical implications or astrophysical analogs. You can also, of late, people are now pushing quantum electrodynamics experiments with these kind of lasers. And of course, you can have nuclear fusion, nuclear excitation, if you have appropriate target material. So this is something which characterizes this area. And this is perhaps something that you should keep in your minds. So this is literally what is called laboratory astrophysics these days. And if you compare various objects in the universe or various living things in the universe, so from this one has all across the scales, the x-axis has number density in particles per meter cube, the y-axis has temperature in Kelvin, the log scales, of course. And you see that ultra-cold neutral plasma is also plotted on the same scales, just to give an example of what is what. So this is very low density and very low temperature. But on the other hand, you go towards a white dwarf or you go towards solar core, you reach high densities and high temperatures. And interestingly, inertial confinement fusion, which deals with high energy density science, is up there, way up there, along with, you know, these stellar objects. So it's not an exaggeration to say that we can now literally bring stars down to Earth. And so you can do experiments which can mimic stellar conditions right on a tabletop in the lab. So this is a review. I'd like to sort of advertise this review. It's rather old, but it's tutorial-like. So I believe the subject is still, the basics are still the same. So the students might want to take a look and then send me their comments if, you know, how I should write this in future if I decide to write one more of this. So this appeared in 2009. And so let me now just tell you that the plasma is now a system with characterized by extreme excitation. But not only that, it has different scales. So you can have bulk electrons, or what we call most of the electrons which are semi-thermalized or thermalized, can have temperatures which are of the order of 100 EV, 10 to 100 EV or so. But then there's these hot electrons, which are actually jets of particles created by the plasma wave crashing. There's a tsunami that I referred. And so these ones can have temperatures which are orders of magnitude larger, KeV to MeV. In fact, some people say you shouldn't really call it temperature, but this is understood in a certain sense in the community, that this is the kind of, you know, if you look at it like a like an average energy for this system or something like that, then you can call it as KeV to MeV temperatures. And again, this is the only way to produce femtosecond electron pulses at huge fluxes, right? There's no other way that I know of. And this is the scene of action in our lab and many other labs around the world. So you have this target, hapless target, which is blown apart by this, the surface at least is blown apart by this high intensity laser pulse, huge excitation created. It can emit all the way up to gamma rays, right? It can also emit all the way low down to terahertz. It can emit relativistic electrons. It can emit very high energy, high charged ions. It can even emit positrons, right? When the gamma rays break down by pair production, it can emit positrons. And if you have nuclear material there, like deuterium or something like that, you can have fusion reactions producing a neutron. Producing neutrons. So you can have a tabletop one-stop source for lots and lots of secondary particles, all of them ultra-short in duration, right? At least most of them. And that means you can now open a lab which can do many, many other explorations using these secondary particles. And I'm going to focus on one or two things of this. The first thing is that, mainly at the hot electrons which are streaming into the target, just to give you a flavor of the kind of measurements that are possible. So I told you that these hot electrons which are streaming into the target, you know, these green particles here, assume that they're actually traveling at very high speeds in this behind this critical layer. And they're in the form of a jet. These are mega ampere pulses. In fact, the current densities can be trillion amperes per centimeter square because it's a very small focal spot. And if you compute the number of electrons there and calculate the density, it is trillion amperes per centimeter square that we have measured in our lab at TIFR. And obviously, this is abnormally large electron current will produce very large magnetic fields. And that's been one of our themes over the last several years. So I'll tell you a little about what we know about these electrons and what are the kind of magnetic fields that generate and how do we measure these things. So the problems are many because this is a highly challenging environment experimentally. So it's hot, it's dense, it's violent, it's turbulent, it evolves extremely rapidly. And most importantly, it's a very, very noisy environment. If you want to capture a signal, you need to go to great lengths to actually to screen out several other emissions which are also interfering with that signal that you want to measure. So measurements are a big problem in this system, but then people have beaten all odds to get lots of information about what goes on here. So this is the theme now. The hot electrons are the primary carriers of the laser energy, right? It's not the thermalized electrons, which take only about 10 to 15%, but the hot electrons carry much of this energy in the form of current pulses of these electrons. So how do you see them? So this is an old picture. It's a favorite of mine, one of the earliest to take a snapshot of these electrons. So this is what is called shadowgraphy. Somebody is interested, I can explain later. So they're taking a picture of these electrons as it moves in the target. It's even excited by a beam, a main laser beam coming from the bottom to hitting the target here. And there are two kinds of electron clouds that you see here. One semi-isotropic expansion, and then there are these jets, you know. So these are our own electron jets here, which are moving here. And these jets, you can take this length scale, and this is a snapshot at 1.2 picoseconds. So divide this length by this time, and you will notice quickly that this is about 0.7 times the speed of light. So they are really very, very fast electrons, right? And but that's okay to take a snapshot and then, you know, say that, okay, they are there. But how do you know what their characteristics are, what their energies are, right? And what is the distribution of energies? Because they are not having all the same energies. So towards that end, we did some measurements at TFR I'd like to tell you about now. So the electrons are moving at speeds close to that of light in vacuum. That's important. But remember, there's a target through which they are moving. And the target can have a refractive index of its own. And if the target has a refractive index, then light starts moving slower than the electrons in that medium, because the light will travel at C by refractive index. So the light slows down. But the electrons can be moving faster than C by N. And when electrons move faster than C by N in a medium, we have this beautiful signal called Cherenkov radiation, which is widely used across physics. It won a Nobel Prize long, long ago for Professor Cherenkov. And this is used by particle physics in very heavily for detecting very, very fast particles. So on the right-hand side, you have this bluish glow in a water tank created by these fast particles, which are streaming through. So a charged particle going faster than the speed of light in the medium emits Cherenkov radiation is well known. And there are some very nice characteristics of this in the sense that the angle depends on the speed of the electron, right? Of course, on the refractive index. And you can compute the number of photons by these expressions that are given on the left here. But we don't go into those details. You can read about them in any standard electrodynamics book. And the beauty is that the cone will give you a wonderful picture, which is, you know, different colors at different cone angles. And that is again mapped to the electron energies. So you have this wonderful, I'll show you very shortly an experiment that we did with Japanese colleagues right in our lab at TIFR. So don't worry about the details, but at the bottom, you have a Cherenkov trace, which is like a horseshoe, given the geometry of the target. It was actually a prism target that was used for various reasons. And on the right-hand side at the bottom, you have the electron energies which are measured. So ignore the blue, but just look at the blue and red, the black and red curves here, the red data points here. And you can see that you have these electrons we have been able to capture at 1 MeV electrons, 1.5, 2 MeV electrons, and so on. So these are not at the highest intensities. We can even go higher, and we can actually capture better these days. So we have improved our diagnostics, so we can even go up to a few MeV to about all the way till maybe close to 10 MeV electrons. So the other thing was to actually see, you know, what these dynamics of these megaampere electron pulses inside the solid are. I will come to that in a minute, but let me just tell you that these things are all happening extremely fast inside the solid. You know, I'm talking about things moving on picosecond, sub-picosecond timescales. So the crucial question is, either you take endpoint information, say beginning and end, and say, I don't know what happened in between, or to see things as they happen, that's the first thing, and also where they happen. So both are important. As they happen tells you the time evolution. Where they happen tells you about the spatial resolution that you can have. Which part of the plasma is evolving at what rate? So these are the crucial questions that TIFR has sort of spent a lot of time over the last 10 years or so investigating. So this is what is called, it's a 40 FDIFR, ultrafast dynamics of the plasma, both spatially and spatially and temporally resolved dynamics of the plasma. So let me show you how this thing is done in the lab. So you have a pump beam, you have a probe beam, and the pump can be at one wavelength, you know, your primary laser. The probe can need not be at the same wavelength. It can be actually altered in its color by various manipulations. Its frequency can be changed or wavelength can be changed. Its polarization can be tailored, and it can be given special signatures that you can track later. And the beauty is that the pump created plasma starts evolving with time, and the probe goes at a certain time delay and then asks the plasma, what is your status right now? What state are you in right now? And that state is captured by the reflection of the probe beam. So if you send a probe beam and then catch its reflection and send it to various devices, you can get information on several plasma processes that are happening here. For example, if it goes to what is called a polarimeter, you're measuring a polarization change, and that tells you that, you know, what is the magnetic field there, something similar to what you have in Faraday rotation. So let me show you how this experiment is actually done. So you have this chamber. We took the lid off for you just to show that you can see what is there inside. You have the pump beam coming, causing a plasma there, and a probe beam comes later and then gets, you know, directed to several diagnostics, detectors, spectrometers, and what have you. So you can, in one shot, you can measure several characteristics of this plasma for every excitation that you do. So this is an actual chamber inside our chamber that where we have lots of optics. This is just to give a feel to the students. And all these experiments are set up by our, very proud to say that they are set up by our PhD students. So those among you who are, you know, want to pursue this area, it's well within your, you know, capabilities that you will learn on once you enter TIFR. And so this is a bit of ad for doing experimental physics in this area. So that's how the pump beam comes, gets directed, gets shaped, and finally gets focused onto the target, which is kept at the center. And voila, there's a huge explosion and this plasma is created there. By the way, all these things are done in vacuum, though for this purpose, we actually took out, removed the vacuum, sort of leaked gas into the chamber and then took these photos when it was open. So let me just tell you this theme about something that I alluded to, saying that life of these relativistic electrons. I told you about the energy of these electrons a short while ago, MeVs and so on, measured by Cherenkov emission. But how long do these electrons live? That's again something that we investigated in the last few years. And again, what we did this time was the Cherenkov emission that comes is also a pulse, right? And the Cherenkov emission comes as long as the pulses are relativistic. If they go below the relativistic threshold, it stops, right? So we can figure out how fast these electrons are getting damped in their energy by measuring the time evolution of Cherenkov signal. And that's what we did using a technique called optical Kerr gate. Details again, you can ask me later, but let me just show you the kind of signals that come. And there's some very nice information here. The red pulse that you see is the laser, and the blue pulse that you see is the laser that has traveled a certain distance towards the diagnostics, right? But you notice that the Cherenkov emission, which is indicated in these black dots, actually is faster than the light pulse that has reached the same diagnostic level, the area, because this is coming from electrons which are actually faster than the light in the target. So the emission has actually preceded the laser while it travels to the detector. But the interesting thing that you see here is that a femtosecond electron pulse emits Cherenkov emission for as long as tens of picoseconds. So the energy takes so long to damp out. And this is something that we are trying to, you know, understand still. These are still new measurements. We only have a partial answer to this question, why they are so long lived. And we are not sampling the full electrons. We are sampling only a few of these fast electrons, perhaps the fastest of the fast electrons. And we have done it in several targets. You notice here the refractive index of a normal glass is 1.5. Then we looked around for refractive indices which are higher. So this LAS SF35 glass, and this can now, because it's a higher refractive index, even 79 keV electrons are relativistic here. They can emit Cherenkov radiation. So we've been able to do a differential measurement by using different refractive indices for these targets. The only requirement is that the target has to be transparent. Otherwise, you can't get the Cherenkov signal. So there you are. So we tried again. This is a theory, which is that curve at the you know, and the data points are all experiments. So you know that we still have a way to go before we can fully interpret everything here. But I just showed it to say that this is something very exciting. And this research is actually moving further along this direction in our lab. And this is a paper that we published, and the methods are given in this paper at the bottom. So please take a look if you're interested. And now the final theme perhaps of my talk would be something to do with the giant magnetic fields, right? And I've written astrophysical analogs. So those of you who might you know, be astrophysicists might be amused by this, the fact that your tabletop, you know, small laser like ours can actually talk of something to do with astrophysics. But I'll convince you that indeed it can. So we measure the magnetic field again by what I call the optical polarimetry. And this is a pulse that we discovered way back in the early 2000s, right? So this is one of my first few PhD students, Arvinder Sandhu, who measured this. And the surprise was that even at modest intensities of 10 to the 16 watts per centimeter square, you have a pulse which is as large as 25 to 30 megahertz. And the pulse lasts only a few picoseconds, right? And it doesn't go on for a long time. And why does more recently we have much larger intensities here, and so higher magnetic fields all the way up to 70 megahertz or so. And the physics is all given here in one quick, simple picture, that the hot electrons that are created here, look at this picture at the bottom. So the hot electrons actually stream in to the target, and the hot electrons have an electric field, which then induces a return current from this target material. For example, it ionizes the target material and induces return currents by way of induction. So now you have a forward current here, you have a return current here, and you have an interaction here between the two that sets the resultant, the rest of the dynamics. And this equation here describes how this magnetic field grows and dies. So you have this dB by dt, which is, there's a source term here, and then there's a diffusion term here. And the crucial parameter that conducts this, that controls this, is the conductivity of this hot dense matter that's given here. So we also looked at the spatial evolution, and let me show you a 2D map of the magnetic field across the face of the plasma. So this is across the face of the plasma. The plasma is not a point, but a surface. And I have this scale for the magnetic field at the top. And I have this, let me start the clock now. If I start the clock, you can see the magnetic field jump up and down at different parts. A spiky, you know, highly non-uniform, inhomogeneous distribution there. And this, by the way, are among the first few maps of the magnetic field across the face of the plasma. In fact, many people did not know how the magnetic field evolved on a two-dimensional scale, that is across the transverse scale of the plasma. So these are simulations done by other groups in Japan, and which also predicted that the spiky nature of this magnetic field has to do with what is called the filamentation. And the filamentation is because of the repulsion between the forward current and the return current that I mentioned. And the repulsion between the two actually tears up the electron beam and fragments it. And the fragmentation was called the filamentation. And you can see that in A and B, you have this, and C, you have the electron density, which is filamented, highly filamented kind of electron density. And A and C then show you, the A and B show you the magnetic field, which is highly localized, which is what we captured in our pictures of the magnetic field. So this is what is known as the Weibull instability. So the Weibull instability causes these giant magnetic fields by separating the hot electron current and the cold electron current, which then interact and break up. And we captured them in great glory in our lab. So this is a time map of the 2D profiles from left to right. And if you take the Fourier transform of these guys, these pictures here, and you get what is called a power spectrum. So the Fourier map follows a power law. So the individual maps look very, very random and disconnected from one another. But the power spectrum is beautifully fitted by a slope of -2. And anything which has got a power spectrum like this is a clear indication of the turbulence system in the system. So here, this is actually a turbulent magnetic field. So, and the the inset shows the simulations done in a supercomputer by our collaborators elsewhere. So, and this is what is called the sun-like magnetic turbulence produced in a lab plasma. And this made quite a bit of noise when it appeared. And this is the turbulent magnetic field that they're referring to. We know that the sun has lots of interesting magnetic phenomena. We have an 11-year solar cycle. We have sunspot activity. We have magnetic reconnection, which causes flares and whatnot. So to an extent, it's perhaps possible to create some of these conditions right in the lab now. And if you go further and do measurements over a longer time scale, you not only have one slope, you have, if you look at this 49 to 75 picoseconds evolution, you have one slope here followed by another slope, and there's a knee formation that happens. And the knee formation happens very quickly because of what is called, the electron-mediated turbulence going over into ion-mediated turbulence at that point. And this is a characteristic feature of several satellite observations of solar flares, solar photosphere, solar wind, Earth's magneto sheath. All of them have changing slopes of this magnetic field. And these observations have been done over several years in the satellites. But it's interesting to see that they have the same kind of kinky behavior at a certain kind of time scale, which indicates that there is a crossover from one kind of behavior to another. And we published a paper three years ago, saying that this is, our lab turbulence, lab magnetic field turbulence, mimics these astrophysical scenarios by displaying similar characteristics in the magnetic field energy density. So this was called turbulent tabletops by Nature Physics in a commentary. And their words, they say that you can create a miniaturized solar system in the lab. So these are not my words, but it is the words of the Nature Physics guys who wrote this story. So terrestrial lab astrophysics is possible now, is being established in great style. And unlike astrophysics, which takes things as they come, when they come, and if you miss it, you just miss it, right? Here you can create these conditions repeatably, reproducibly, and with high multiplicity of diagnostics. If some detector failed in one shot, you can revive the detector and then take another shot, right? You can't do that in standard astrophysics. So scale down experiments, right, are possible because of the loss of hydrodynamics that both the systems obey in spite of large differences in magnitudes. You're talking about, light years and billions of years and whatnot in astrophysics. And here you're talking about microns and picoseconds and so on, but still scaling is possible. And you can test laboratory astrophysical models on a lab scale. So, I still have one more thing for just a couple of minutes maybe. So I'll just say that this is something I can't resist showing because this is a TIFR discovery or TIFR invention, if you will, that TIFR now can produce neutral beams at millions of electron volts. This is done by my colleague M. Krishnamurthy. It was his and his students' discovery. Normally you would wonder, neutral atoms are not charged, right? So how do you excite them to MeV energies and how do you produce beams of them? So this is again something that is facilitated by the high intensity laser. Very quickly, this is the paper that was published. You can read more details. The fact is that there is a particle, a cluster of atoms, which is exploded by this laser pulse, gets ionized very rapidly. And while the electrons leave, the ions are now a positive charge cloud and they explode. While the ions from this exploding ion cloud leave the environment, they get neutralized by the surrounding gas, right? And that's why they still have energies which are MeV because of the explosion, but they get neutralized on the way, so they lose their charge. And this is what we cheekily call staying neutral under intense provocation. The laser intensities are extraordinarily large, but at the end of it, you don't have a charge particle, you have a neutral atom, right? So read more about this. And MK and co have now pushed it to many other kind of systems. That was a gas target, a cluster target. And this is actually a solid target, which is more common. And here again, they are actually producing neutrals, so a recombination of protons, which neutralizes them. And this is a more recent paper that they have produced. So TIFR, of course, has been investigating many other themes, shocks. We want to enhance fast electrons by structuring targets in a certain way. Electron transport is an enduring theme in our lab. Neutral, positive, negative ion acceleration is again another major theme. And we are interested in all sorts of secondary sources that we can produce with this kind of excitation. So where are we going? Very quickly, we are now expanding in Hyderabad, in new campus, I said, with a petawatt laser. And so from the coast, we're going to the interiors. And we hope to have by 2022 a petawatt laser to produce even more extreme light, right? But it will be done in the Hyderabad campus, where we have much larger space for doing many more experiments than in Colaba, in Bombay. So hopefully at 10 to the 21, we want to understand extremes again of, you know, this magnetic fields, densities, how do we control this? And several technologies that become possible, from producing GeV electrons on a tabletop to positron pulses, attosecond pulses, what have you. And many of these also have applications, societal applications for medical imaging, you know, biological imaging, medical therapies, and various other things. And we'll also be moving towards the quantum electrodynamics on a tabletop. So this is where the world is also going. So we're trying to catch up. So the world is now going towards 10 to the 22, 23 kinds of intensities with big lasers in Europe, which is called the extreme light infrastructure, and also in China. So we will, hopefully we will enter the, what is called the positron electron era and the quark era in the near future. And beyond that, it's anybody's guess. So this is what we hope to do in Hyderabad in one setting, extremely, different types of physics, but it's the same laser, it's the same target, but depending on who comes, he might ask different questions. So this is also, because of the focus that we have had on in this area, we are very happy to show that the UK, we have a long-standing collaboration with them. We have started a new innovation center at Hyderabad. It's called the EPIC, Extreme Photonics Innovation Center, where we'll produce these beams for imaging and therapies and so on, and we'll characterize them. So we hope to do this in great style in the next few years. In fact, this center has just been opened with the UK funding listed here, and TFR is providing contributions by way of its facilities, its manpower, and training of people here, and so on and so forth. So, but together we will invent new technologies for the next generation of high power lasers. So to really conclude now, I think it's a research field which is hot, happening, extremely exciting. And with 1 eV photons, imagine where all you have been going over the last 1 hour or so. And this high energy density science has been democratized by these compact lasers. And the future should certainly see lots of people talking, in the same experiment, you can pose lots of questions. So convergence of different scientific areas on a tabletop in one experiment. So that's our website. If you can't visit us, at least visit us on the website and then tell us, learn about what we are doing and tell us what you find interesting and how we can improve things. And thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Ravi. Yeah, it was really a wonderful talk and very insightful and like as exciting as ever. So thank you so much on behalf of all of us who are here. And then I would like to, open this for the questions. So on behalf of the, So let me just check the questions and then ask you. Okay, so there is one question from Basavaraj Kagali. Yeah. He's asking, could you please explain chopped pulse amplification that won the Nobel Prize recently? Okay.
Yeah, so chopped pulse amplification refers to a trick or a method whereby, you can't amplify femtosecond pulses directly because their peak power is already very high. And if you start amplifying them, very soon they'll damage everything inside, including the laser itself. So what people have done is to do a little bit of trickery. So they take the femtosecond pulse, which is capable of being a femtosecond pulse because it has the bandwidth, and they stretch it in time by what is called chirping. So chirping is a process by which you can actually stretch the pulse, and the stretch pulse now lowers its peak power by the same factor of stretching. So after that, you can give it more juice or more amplification, you can pack more energy in. And finally, because it was originally a femtosecond pulse, you can actually compress it back to the femtosecond duration. So now you have much more energy in the same duration, nearly the same duration as the original pulse. If you began with the original pulse, you would have reached a very small amplification before which everything starts getting damaged. So that's what is called the chirp pulse amplification. So stretch, amplify, and compress.
Okay, so there is another question. With the present high density laser pulses, can you produce elementary particles and quarks? I think he meant high intensity.
That's too far-fetched. And that brings a smile to my face because I think it's too far-fetched. It's, there is a proposal that if you go to, it's a theoretical limit. There's something known as the Schwinger limit. If you go to 10 to the 29 watts per centimeter square, 10 to the 29, by the way, currently we are at 10 to the 22, 10 to the 23 aspiring to be. And if you go millions of a million factor higher, you can actually produce, people say that you can produce electrons and positrons from vacuum, the quantum mechanical vacuum, right? The Dirac vacuum. But some clever tricks have been used whereby you don't need such high intensities, but you can see similar signatures using accelerated beams and light fields of very high intensity. But fundamental particles, I think we still have a long way to go. I mean, electron is a fundamental particle, so we are producing, but quarks, well, no way.
Yeah, so, okay, one more question here I can see. Are you able to produce nuclear fusion reactions with high intensity pulses?
Yes, in fact, that's one of the goals for this high energy density science area, which has been funded heavily. The reason is that we think that we can produce nuclear fusion in deuterium tritium capsule, irradiated by lasers, and then we will beat our power problem. You know, we don't need carbon, the gas or coal stations, which are polluting the atmosphere with CO2, right? Very bad effects. But the fusion has not worked so far because the plasma has been a beast that has not been easy to tame. There's been so much of plasma physics learned over the last 50 years, but still it throws up surprises. So currently at the National Ignition Facility in the US, they tried very hard to produce fusion. Fusion events happen, but enough fusion, enough number of events such that you can overcome, you can produce an extra power from what you have used. That has not happened, but fusion reactions happen routinely in any experiment like this, if you have the right material. So that's really not a problem. But power plants, which are based on fusion, not yet.
Okay. Then there is a question from Uttam Pal. He is asking, do you foresee any fundamental physics from going to terawatt to petawatt to any higher intensities?
I believe all this has been fundamental. I don't know what you mean by fundamental, because for the first time we're able to investigate, you know, most of the universe is in this state. By the way, on the Earth, we are at very, very moderate conditions. Fortunately, otherwise life wouldn't be possible. But deep inside the Earth, if you leave the surface of the Earth and go deeper into the Earth or go high up in space, most of the universe is in this hot and, excited conditions, very high densities, high temperatures. Not been possible to produce till recently, till these lasers came along. There were other ways of producing in nuclear explosions, but they are not desirable, right? So if I ask you what is the behavior of materials or matter at extraordinarily high pressures and temperature, if I ask you equation of state for some system, say aluminium at very high pressures and temperatures, we don't know. It is to be discovered. There are no models because there is no data. I mean, anybody can say anything and you can get away with it. So for the first time, we are pushing matter to the extreme, observing it, providing some basic descriptions in terms of the data, so that we can now give enough material to the people who can model these systems. And if you know ideal gas is great because we know the equation of state. You know how pressure, volume, and temperature are related. But you don't know that for most materials, and certainly not across the ranges of pressures and temperatures. So I believe this is a very fundamental science, and we're going towards, if by fundamental you had things at the level of particle physics, I think eventually the goal will be to investigate some fundamental physics processes using these lasers. But at the moment, I think we are learning several other fundamental things using extreme excitations in all normal matter. So that's my answer to this question.
Yeah, then one more interesting question. What is the maximum intensity of electron possible to extract by illuminating with laser?
Intensity or energy? I don't know. Let me take both. So intensities are governed by, you know, for example, if you take a solid, you have a solid and then you have this critical, that's a 10 to the 21 particles per cc. So you can create with this high energy electron beams. If you go behind the critical layer, you can produce densities which are 10 to the 22 particles per cc, excited to very high temperatures, right? So you can say solid densities can be excited, but there are experiments where you can compress matter with laser pulses. So you can cause what is called in laser fusion, that's how laser fusion is supposed to work. So you can implode materials. The material is sort of crushed by laser pulses, right? And that can produce densities which are about, say, 1,000 times the liquid density, or 10 to the 23, 10 to the 24 particles per cc. So we have produced such matter, but of course, the future might be totally different. I don't know what will happen. So at the moment, you can go till something like 1,000 times of liquid density with different set of lasers, not these kind of lasers that I talked about, but with nanosecond high energy, megajoule kind of lasers. But with these lasers, we are able to go till something like sub-solid densities, but at high temperatures.
Yeah, so maybe I'll take like one or two more questions. Yeah, so what is the highest energy density produced using the most powerful laser in the world? Or basically, Raghunath Sahu, he wants to know the...
So I think this is some paper that attracted my attention, came in April 2020, done at the National Ignition Facility. And they are now going to what is called the degenerate matter. So let me explain what is degenerate matter. You know, the stellar, all of us know that the stars are sort of collapsing under their own gravity. And that's how the reactions are taking place inside. And they will go on collapsing. So what is the end point of a star is a great question in astrophysics, which has been answered by the famous Indian physicist, S. Chandrasekhar, who said the limit for a star to go one way or the star to go another way, this is a Chandrasekhar mass limit, right? Now, if you think of just one scenario, the gravity keeps on crushing matter to smaller and smaller volumes. There comes a time when the electrons build up what is called the degeneracy pressure. This is purely quantum mechanical. That is that the two electrons being fermions, they are governed by the Pauli's exclusion principle. So they cannot share the same sort of phase space in some sense, right? So they cannot get too close to each other. So there will be a pressure that will counter the gravitation, right? And this is what is called the degenerate state. And I was very happy to see this paper from the National Ignition Facility, which appeared in April 2020 in Nature Physics, that now they are getting to a state inside what is this, I think, brown dwarf, something where this degenerate state is known to exist. So they are matching interstellar degenerate conditions. So, which is, I think, really remarkable. So, people are able to crush things using lasers, which are going all the way down to at least partial degeneracy, if not complete degeneracy. And very soon, I'm sure they will reach the ultimate limits of that. And that will be a state that you can experience for the first time on the Earth in that experiment. Otherwise, you'll have to go all the way up to the stars, and you can't do that either way.
Okay, so very quickly, I'll take the last question from YouTube. How do you measure billion Tesla magnetic field in the lab?
Okay, so this is, as I said, it's, when light goes through a magnetic field or passes through a medium where there's a magnetic field, it undergoes changes in its polarization state. So by mapping out the polarization state coming out of the plasma, once you shine light on it, and then you see that the polarization state has changed, that change in the state can be mapped onto the local magnetic field there. So you can imagine, all of you may have read in school or maybe undergraduate studies, that there's something known as Faraday rotation, where the light polarization rotates when you go through a glass piece which where there's a magnetic field applied. So this is something similar. It's a little more specialized, but something similar.
Yeah, so I would like to actually request maybe who are in the Zoom, if they can ask the question themselves, because some of the questions are a little large. So I would like to request Mr. Devakant Sasmal. Yeah, if you would like to ask directly.
Unmute, yeah. Unmute yourself and ask the question.
Yeah.
Or do we have to unmute?
Maybe he's not present. Okay, anyway, so maybe I'll just read. In recent days, people working in the condensed matter physics have discovered 3D Dirac or Weyl electrons.
Okay.
And in bracket, he's saying relativistic electrons in material system. I am wondering if there is any crucial difference in the properties of relativistic electrons in these two cases, the physics relativistic electrons that you are mentioning.
Yeah, so I think the difference is that is still, you know, in matter that is sort of stable together. I'm talking about electrons which have been stripped off from matter, which are now free particles racing away. So, you know, it's not true that relativistic effects are seen even in atoms, right? But that's a different story. That is still bound matter, that is still stable matter. But this is actually ionized and sort of, if you can call completely apart from that, totally ionized matter. So that's the difference. These are, and there may be quantum mechanical effects there, but in many of the things that I've talked about, quantum mechanics is not needed to explain. Most of these things are classical, explained by classical physics, because the temperature of the systems is much, much larger than the binding. And so they are, you know, free particles which can be described by classical statistical and classical electrodynamic methods.
Yeah, and this will be concluding question. This is from Professor Vandana. If you can comment on compact laser accelerator for medical applications.
Okay. Well, I think that question will be tough to answer. You know, the thing is that we have shrunk the accelerator in size. So what typically we've all begin this laser accelerator talks by saying, you know, what happens over hundreds of meters there, we can do it in 1 centimeter on a gas, on a tabletop. But the rep rates have been a problem. We can reach GeV electrons, we can reach MeV electrons are trivial now, but the densities are not too large, of course, because these are usually gas targets which are used, and a part of the gas is ionized, and so part of the gas particle density is what is kept in the, what is extracted in the electron beam. But the crucial difference with the other conventional accelerators is the rep rate. So unless we beat the rep rate problem, right now it's at a few hertz, maybe it'll go to 100 hertz, but the other accelerators are going at, you know, much larger, higher rep rates. So that would be tough to beat right now, unless there is a change in laser technology. But I think it might happen soon. So compact in the sense that they might be good for doing test studies, you know, checking out therapies in the lab, whether they work or not. The proton therapy triggered by lasers, laser-induced high-energy protons, MeV protons. People are testing, you know, whether they will destroy cancer cells. And that's been a huge activity in Europe, several fundings for those kind of activities. But I think the lab and realistic hospital scale, I think will be still some time off.
Okay, with this, I would like to hand over to Professor Vandana Nanal for the concluding remarks.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Amitabh. First of all, thanks to Professor Ravindra Kumar for an excellent talk. There have been a lot of appreciative comments by the viewers, but I would definitely like to mention one. Someone says that this was the first time he heard the talk on the laser. So I think he was very fortunate to have it from you, and I'm really happy that people, so much appreciation was also mentioned for the talk. I mean, you really spanned on the many things and brought the stars to the table to tell tell
okay.
So thank you very much for the talk.
Thank you all the audience for, I believe I exceeded my time by a large amount. But that's one of the things that you, Vandana, I warned you before.
No, but that's the advantage of having this one lecture, right? It was not like you're eating into somebody else's time that we had to stop. So that allows free flow.
As I said, we speak for hours on femtoseconds. But, that's a problem.
Sorry?
We speak for hours on femtoseconds.
Yeah. There are a few more questions. And I think, as you mentioned in the beginning, people can write to you, email, and I'm sure you'll be happy to answer the questions. So we will end today's session here. So before we end, just to remind you all that please join us back on next Saturday. Next Saturday, we'll have a talk from Professor Arup Rai Chaudhary, and the title is almost a Shakespearean, To Be or Not To Be, about the Griffith's phase transition. So stay tuned, stay safe, and see you back next Saturday. Thank you, all the viewers and the
thanks
speaker. And
thanks,
thank
Amitabh.
You, Amitabh, for wonderfully conducting the lecture. Thanks,
it's my pleasure.
Yeah.
Thank you,
everyone.
Yeah. Bye. Stopping the recording now. Mm-hmm.